Hello, my fellow DO students, James here. Hopefully this can help you learn some OPP for your next exam. Obviously, I'm not gonna read everything on this paper, just doing a brief overview. If you need to pause the video, go ahead. And in Fryette's laws, here we go. Of course, there's law 1, law 2, and law 3 of the thoracic and lumbar vertebrae. Little way to remember, law 1, neutral position, rotation, and side bending are opposite. Law 2, flexed or extended, that's in the same direction. Look at those little arrows right there. And law 3 just says one motion will restrict other motions. Our superior facet orientation. The superior facet influences how the spine moves. A little memory trick here. Bum, bull, bum. The facet orientations, backward, upward, medial. Backward, upward, lateral. Backward, medial. Right here tells you how to name a somatic dysfunction of the spine. So let's start at the top here. Cervical spine. You have the OA joint, occipito-atlanto joint over here. OA, opposite always. Rotation and side bending are always opposite. Then we have the atlanto-axial joint. Movement of this is rotation. Then we have the typical vertebrae. Rotation and side bending are always the same. Let's go to the thoracic spine here. Main motion, rotation. Rule of threes. And this all has to do with the spinous processes. So T1 through 3, the spinous processes are small, so it's associated with the transverse process of that vertebrae. Notice the blue line here? This is the same level as this. T4 through 6, spinous process is a little lower, so it's halfway. T7 through 9, the spinous process is longer, and it's about equal with the transverse process of the one below it. So this one and this one. So T10 through 12 involve all three of those. Long, medium, short. All right, let's go to the lumbar spine here. Lumbar spine, flexion and extension, main motion. And then we have spinal stenosis, can read up upon that. Herniated discs over here. We have the iliopsoas muscle right there. Psoas syndrome. Oh, look at that error. See right there, spelled that wrong. Test that with the Thomas test right here. Scoliosis, holding up your hands. If your left hand goes with the curve, you know it's levoscoliosis. Left, levo. Then if your right hand goes with the curve, then you know it's dextroscoliosis. Really easy way to figure out what kind of curve it is. Then you have structural curve versus a functional curve, forward bend test, Cobb angle, short leg syndrome, lumbar spine side bends away from the short leg, and you have an anatomical short leg versus a functional short leg. All right, let's go to the pelvis now. Pelvic shears hand trick. School taught me this. Notice we have hands here. Then their thumb pointing up, your index finger pointing out, and your middle fingers pointing inwards towards each other. The thumbs represent the PSIS, pointer finger represents the ASIS, and the middle part represents the pubic symphysis. From the standing flexion test, you can determine pretty much the diagnosis for your pelvic shears. Then here's all the different kinds of innominate dysfunctions and movements. You can have rotations, flares, inflares, outflares, shears of the pubic bone right there. So the hands here, really important to figure out your diagnosis. Sacrum, oh boy, everyone's favorite. So here we have all the sacral ligaments over here. All right, here we go, sacral movement. So we have the left oblique axis and the right oblique axis, and that's transverse axes over here on the side. And that's just how the sacrum moves. So the way you diagnose the sacrum, this will go over here, how you diagnose the sacrum, right here, indicates which side the seated flexion test was positive. The D indicates which side the sacral sulcus is deep. The bottom D, which of the sacral inferior lateral angles was deep. So over here, we have a bunch of diagnoses that you can get. Sacrum in relation to L5. So this is the ROSA. Sacrum is rotated, opposite, side bent, same axis. I guess that O should probably be. If L5 is neutral, rotated left, side bent right, you know that the L, rotated opposite, is an R, side bent right, same, sacrum is right on right. Boop, over on this guy. Rib motion, very important. Three different types of rib motion, and all it has to do with where the axis is. So, rib 1 through 5, pump handle, look, that's where it rotates from, right there. 6 through 10, bucket handle, we have a rotation here, or an axis there, an axis here, so it moves up and down like a bucket handle. 11 and 12 are caliper, so it has one axis right there, and it moves in and out. How do you name ribs? We have the atypical ribs, any rib with a 1 or a 2. So 1, atypical, 2, atypical, 11, atypical, 12, atypical. How it attaches to the sternum is right here. Rib dysfunction, inhaled ribs versus exhaled ribs. Inhaled, it means that it's stuck in inhalation, or stuck up. Exhaled, it's stuck down. Bottom inhaled, top exhaled. That's for the key rib. Which rib do you treat? The key rib, bite. Craniosacral motion. my favorite. Primary respiratory mechanism has different components. Those include the brain, spinal cord motility, the cranial bones, sphenoid here, occiput here. More on that in a little bit. Those things are articulate. The cerebral spinal fluid, how it flows. Membrane movement, e.g. the meninges. Those are connected to the sacrum down here and affect the sacral motility. All right, so we have the occiput and the sphenoid. Here we go. How do they move? The sphenobasilar synchondrosis is joint, I guess you could say. Flexion, extension, torsion, side bending. Right here are just little graphics demonstrating what it's going on. Torsions are named for the superior sphenoid wing. Some cranial techniques. Shoulder. So that's your shoulder joint. Rotator cuff muscles. There we go. Posterior view, we have the spine of the scapula right there. Under the spine, the infraspinatus. Makes sense. The teres minor right here. Above the spine of the scapula, we have the supraspinatus. Then we have the subscapularis, which is on the anterior side of the scapula, represented by this dotted line right here. The supraspinatus tendinitis, very common. Here's how the clavicle moves. It moves opposites. So purple down here is associated with the purple up here. So it moves opposites. Oh, all sorts of palsies here. Herb palsy, Klumpke, radial nerve injury, Saturday night palsy, slumping over the side of a chair, golfer's elbow versus tennis elbow, medial versus lateral epicondylitis. APAND, the thenar eminence. So you notice this red part right here? That shows you what's going on. Thenar eminence, atrophy, fingers flexed. Pope bishop hand, it's the little and ring fingers that are effective. Claw hand, wrist drop, radial nerve injury, right? This guy's name, Dupuytren's contracture. I don't know if I said that right. Maybe you guys can tell me. Rheumatoid arthritic joint problems, swan neck deformities, boutonniere deformity, and how your fingers look. A little mnemonic here, carpal bones. So long to pinky, here comes the thumb. That's spelled wrong. Look at that. Cross that out. Two. Or is it T-O-O? Shoulder dislocation. Anterior dislocation is most common. Wing scapula. Long thoracic nerve injury. Push off the wall and your scapula protrudes out. Your hip joint. Genu varum, genu valgum. You have this L here. The way I remember it, valgum has an L in it. And this kind of looks like an L. Like you're up here. And that seemed to work. Your lateral ankle stabilizing ligaments. This guy right here. This is your anterior talofibular ligament. Always tears first. An ankle sprain, this is the guy that you suspect first for tearing. Then you have your medial stabilizing ligaments right here, your deltoid ligament. Physiological motion of the proximal versus distal fibular head. They move opposites. So if you have a posterior motion of the distal fibular head, you have an anterior motion of the proximal fibular head. Why is this important? Because the common peroneal nerve, or the common fibular nerve, is directly posterior to the proximal fibular head. So if you have a posterior proximal fibular head, you can impinge the common fibular nerve. Here's some knee ligaments here. The unhappy triad is when you have a lateral force, hurts the medial collateral ligament, the anterior cruciate ligament, and the medial meniscus. Not medium, spelling mistake, right there, medial. Good to know stuff. Definition of a somatic dysfunction, SAM, VLN. The components of the somatic system include skeletal, arthroidal and myofascial structures, and related vascular, lymphatic, and neural elements. Here we have TART changes. What are TART changes? Barriers here, how to define a barrier. Types of muscle contracture here. Osteopathic treatment classifications. You have direct, indirect, active, passive. And important to know, myofascial release is all modalities. This is one of the most high-yield things you're gonna see. Viscerosomatic reflexes. Memorize this. The way that I saw this was done was just numbering it T1 through L2, and it's memorizing, you know, this covered 3 or 4. This one covered the next one. This one down 1, down 2. So it's memorizing it just like that. Going through all of these things, because this right here, my friends, is going to be very high yield for your exams. And that's it. Let me know if you saw any other mistakes in the video or on the sheet. Subscribe for more, guys. Hopefully this helps you. See you next time.